What happens when you get angry or scared? And is it the same for everyone? In this lecture, I will tell you how emotions work.
Why are the Dutch angrier than the Japanese? This is the University of the Netherlands.
Have you ever been really scared? I have. It happened a few years ago when I was hiking in the Swiss Alps with my daughter. The trail took us through a cow pasture, which is quite common in that area, and we continued talking and enjoying the beautiful scenery. And then suddenly my daughter said, "Look, Mummy, that cow is dancing." And she pointed to a cow that was jumping about in a very strange way. I could see that some other hikers had brought a dog into the pasture and let the dog run around without a leash. And now the dog was running around the feet of the cow, and that's why the cow was jumping around. The situation made me quite uncomfortable. I could feel my heart rate quickening, and I felt very alert to what was happening around me. So I took my daughter's hand, and we walked a bit faster to get out of the pasture as quickly as possible. But we were right in the middle of the field, and there were cows in all directions. And the cows all seemed to be reacting to the situation as well. They were no longer eating, but watching us. To make matters worse, these cows are of a particular breed called Heeren's cattle, which is well known for being highly aggressive. And then, all of a sudden, one of the cows lowered its head and started running at us. In a fraction of a moment, everything changed. I heard myself shouting, "Run!" to my daughter as we both started running as fast as we could, hand in hand. As we reached the edge of the pasture, I realized that there was an electric fence in our way. Somehow, in a split second, I made the calculation that getting an electric shock would be better or less bad than an encounter with the aggressive cow. And so I lifted up the electric wire to let myself and my daughter through. Luckily enough, the cow did not attempt to follow us past the fence, but it took us a long while before we stopped feeling shaky afterwards. Emotional experiences, especially when they're intense, like that one was, change how we feel, but also what happens in our body, in our brains, and how we behave. In this lecture, I'll explain what emotions actually are and how they can be similar and at the same time different for different people. Of course, we talk about emotions all the time. Think about, "I was furious when he said that," or "I felt so happy when I found out," or "I'm so excited to see her." But can you explain what an emotion really is? Researchers who have tried have found out that it's actually surprisingly difficult. There are different theories that explain emotions in somewhat different ways, but one really key point is that emotions are multi-componential. That means that they consist of different elements or parts. Most of the time when people talk about or think about emotions, what they're referring to are feelings, and feelings are a really important part of emotions, but it's not all there's to them. Emotions often involve expressions. We might frown when we're annoyed or laugh if we find something funny. And when we are emotional, we also behave differently. Think about it. You're much more likely to be physically violent when you're angry than when you're feeling calm or compassionate. Emotions even change what happens in our body. When you're really scared, you might feel your heart beat faster. And when you're in love, you might feel like you have butterflies in your stomach when you're on the way to meet that special person. So emotions also change how we think. If you're scared, you're much more likely to be alert to a faint sound and to think that that sound is relevant to you, that it means a threat. Think about being alone in an empty house on a dark night. Because you're already tense, every time you hear the tiniest noise, you think it's probably an axe murderer. Now, it's important to understand emotions because they're really a key part of how we understand ourselves and how we understand other people. Many of our most important life decisions involve emotions: who we marry, where we live, what work or what hobbies we have. All of these choices depend on our emotions, either in the moment or the emotions we expect to have in the future. So to understand how we deal with things that are important to us, we need to understand emotions. So as I mentioned, one of the key components of emotions is how they feel. And it's often quite straightforward to know how we feel ourselves. But how can we know how other people feel? Well, we might ask them. But not everybody finds it equally easy to talk about how they feel. This can depend on what words they have to explain how they feel. This is something we call emotion granularity. So when you ask people how they feel, some people will simply say, bad, I don't feel good, I'm unhappy. And if you try to prompt them to clarify what they mean in a bit more detail, they may not have the vocabulary to add any more detail. Whereas other people can make really nuanced and fine-grained distinctions. I was so annoyed. No, actually, I was angry, and later I was furious. Of course, people also need to be willing to share how they feel. Some feelings are more of a taboo than others. People are generally quite fine to tell others when they're happy, but they tend not to be so keen to share when they're feeling guilty or ashamed, because that by definition means they've done something that isn't in line with what's considered acceptable in their own culture or social group. Just imagine how willing would you be to share that you feel deeply ashamed of something you've done. But apart from feelings, emotions also change what happens in our brains, and we can measure some of these changes that happen when we experience emotions. For example, did you know that having a good laugh isn't just fun, it also changes your brain chemistry? That's because laughing releases endogenous opioids, chemicals that help you regulate pain. In contrast, in a state of fear, you release a lot of cortisol, a stress hormone. So emotions are biological processes that change the chemical balance in your brain. This can help you react quickly and effectively to the situation that made you emotional. Emotions also affect other parts of your body. Sometimes you really feel emotions in your body. When I was in the mountains that day, my entire body changed when that cow started running after me. My body went from being in a stable and relaxed state to being an absolute explosion of activity. Suddenly, blood was going to my legs to help me run. I was sweating. My breathing was deeper and faster. In one study, people were asked where in their body they felt a change when they experienced different kinds of emotions. And it's fascinating to see how different emotions correspond to changes in different body parts. For example, anger is typically felt in your upper body, maybe because blood rushes to your arms to prepare you to fight. Disgust, on the other hand, is felt in your throat. Happiness is experienced in your entire body, whereas people who feel depressed usually have less activity than normal in their entire body. So when you experience an emotion, it feels a certain way, it changes the chemical balance in your brain, and it also changes what happens in your body. Another important part of emotions is that we often show our emotions to other people. And this is actually one of the ways that we can try to figure out how people around us are feeling, by examining their facial expressions and body language. We frown or smile, slouch or stand up tall. Think of how someone might look when they're ashamed. Their whole body is probably slumping. They look as though they want to hide themselves. And now think of how someone looks who's just found out they want something. They're beaming with joy, with a big smile on their face, and their body is upright and taking up space. And there is some research that studied how our face and body changes when we're proud or ashamed. They did this by studying Olympic athletes who competed in gold medal matches, so situations with very high stakes. The researchers analyzed how people moved their bodies right after winning or losing the match. You can see some images of similar moments here. Can you guess who won and who lost? Winners typically tilt their head back, raise their arms, make fists, and expand their chest. The athletes who lost slumped their shoulders, narrowed their chest, behaviors associated with shame. And the same behaviors were found in athletes from all over the world. Now take a look at these pictures. Again, can you guess who won and who lost? What's interesting is that these are pictures of blind athletes, because the researchers also examined the behaviors of Paralympic athletes who were born blind. That means that they couldn't have seen other people make these movements and thereby learned how people generally look when they're proud or ashamed. So this suggests that some of the ways in which we express emotions are innate. And another reason to think that some of the ways that we express emotions is innate is that some human behaviors are very similar to the behaviors of non-human primates. For example, chimpanzees and gorillas also raise their fists after winning a fight. But our emotional behaviors don't just involve behaviors that others can see, but also behaviors that other people can hear. Think about it, when people are emotional, they make all kinds of different sounds, like laughing, crying, screaming, sighing, even grunting. And it turns out that some of these sounds are quite similar across cultures. Some years ago, I did a study of the sounds that people make when experiencing different emotions in different cultural groups. And I compared the sounds of people in Europe to the sounds of people in a culturally isolated group, the Himba, who live in a remote part of Namibia. And since the Himba don't have any contact with people outside of their own culture, it would be really unlikely for them to have learned about the sounds made by people from other groups. So I want you to listen to a couple of sound fragments. The first one is from a European person. Can you guess what emotion you are hearing?
Blech.
That's right, it's disgust. Now listen to the second sound.
Blech.
It sounds quite similar, right? It's also disgust. That was produced by a person from Namibia. What we found is that the sounds that we make for a lot of different emotions are actually really similar. But that doesn't mean that everybody always sounds exactly the same, because culture can also shape how we express our emotions. A couple of years ago, I did a study with a colleague in Japan, where we used exactly the same procedure in the Netherlands and in Japan to record sounds related to all kinds of different emotions. And then we played the sounds to people in the Netherlands and in Japan. So let's see if you can recognize these emotions. First, a Dutch sound. Which emotion do you hear? Right. Amusement. The person finds something funny. And what about this one from a Japanese person? That person too found something funny. I think it was quite easy to hear the emotion there. So now I want to make it a little bit more difficult. What emotion is this Dutch person expressing? Hopefully, you found it easy to tell that this person was angry. What about this Japanese person?
Huh? Huh?
This is actually anger as well. I actually thought that there was an error when I received the sounds from my Japanese colleague because the sounds didn't sound angry at all to me. And what we found is that Japanese angry expressions didn't sound angry at all to Dutch listeners. But Japanese listeners thought that the Japanese angry sounds sounded really angry. So why might this be? Well, this is what we think. In Japanese society, it's not considered appropriate to express anger directly, because it disrupts the social harmony. So when Japanese people express anger, they do this in a very restrained way. And other people in Japan are attuned to these very subtle anger expressions, but to a Dutch person, it's not clear enough to understand. So even though there may be an innate part to the sounds we make when we have different emotions, that doesn't mean that we all produce them in the same way. Now, circling back to our main question, why are the Dutch angrier than the Japanese? The answer is that Dutch people may not be angrier than Japanese people, but they sound angrier. Emotions are, after all, multi-componential. We feel emotions, we express them with our body, in our language, and in sounds. Some expressions seem to be innate, like pride and disgust. But emotions are also shaped by culture. And so even though a Dutch and a Japanese person might be equally angry, the Dutch person will sound much angrier. Thank you for watching.